G'day. Welcome to Puget Sound Foursquare Church. We're so excited that you're here with us for our Church at Home service. My name is Rich Clark, and I'm one of the team leads here, and today I will be your host. As we kick off today, Pastor Laura and the sound worship team will be leading us in a couple of songs of worship, and we are jumping right in. Will you pray with me? Lord, please be with us today. Please bless everyone watching and our community, Lord. Thank you for your grace and your love. Amen. All right, worship team, we're turning it over to you for a powerful time of worship.
Nothing good in me.
Hey church, wasn't that awesome? Would you go ahead and do me a favor and click that like, follow, subscribe button? Want to take it a step further? Share this service with your timeline for your community to see our church. You never know the lives that will be impacted by simply clicking that share button. Speaking of sharing, I wanted to share three events that are happening here within our church, and we'd love for you to come and be a part of it or be in the know so you can be praying with us. First, Easter is right around the corner. Join us on Saturday, March 27th at 8 a.m. to help spruce up our building in anticipation of our Easter guests. There's a job for all skill levels and ages. And as a thank you, we'll be providing lunch, so be sure to sign up online so we know you're coming. Family, there is nothing sweeter than standing in front of your church family and promising to raise your little ones to love Jesus. Join us for our regular services on March 21st as we set time aside for baby dedications. And if you're interested in dedicating your child, please fill out the interest form online. Don't forget to spring ahead 1 hour this Saturday. We'll be here at our regular service times, in person here at Tacoma at 9 and 11, online at 10 a.m., and on our Fox Island campus at 5 p.m. online. Church, while you're on our website or on the Church Center app, don't forget to tithe. Whether it's there or through the mail, you guys can still give to the church and help us continue to be the hands and feet of Jesus for our church body. And your generosity continues to help us do the incredible things in this city of Tacoma. All right, kids, I'm sending it over to Pastor Heather right now for our weekly Kids Corner. Remember, you can access everything by visiting our website. Hey, Pastor Heather, sending it over to you in 3, 2, 1.
Hi, kids, Pastor Heather here. Welcome to Kids Corner. Did you have a chance to watch last week's video called Running Away? If you didn't, that's okay. Just have your parents find the newsletter I sent and have them click on the link. Today's story is called Washed with Tears. Last week, we talked about how rules are sometimes hard to follow. This week, we learn about people who loved rules so much that they didn't know how to love people too. Someone uninvited shows up to a dinner, and these rule followers sit back and they talk badly about her. But Jesus defends her and speaks to them about their heart. Have you ever followed a rule and felt like you were the best person, but in your heart and mind, you were thinking how mad that rule made you? Jesus wants us to follow the rules that honor him in our hearts, not just our action. Both are important. And one of the biggest rules that he puts in the Bible is to love God and to love others too. He calls these commandments. These rules aren't just things to do because they make people happy. These rules speak about love, and love comes from the heart. Jesus wants us to live according to his rules so that others would find out how much he loves them. We should never let a rule cause us to hurt someone else. Okay, kids, that's all for today. To find out about the rest of the story, make sure you tune in. I hope you have a great Sunday and that I get to see you all very soon. Bye-bye.
All right, church, Pastor Lance is back, and he's coming at you with a new sermon series. Everyone type follow me in the comment section, as that is the new sermon series. I pray that the word speaks, comforts, and reveals so much to you today. All right, you guys ready? You ready? Without further ado, here's Pastor Lance.
Hey, good morning, Puget Sound Foursquare. Great to have you here with us. I'm Pastor Lance. Listen, if you've been with us for the first time today, or the first time in a long time, welcome home. It's good to have you with us today. We're super excited. Hey, I want to give you a little update on how things are going with our joining together of Trinity Church and Puget Sound Foursquare. I wrote down a few things here. I want you to know that the process is underway. Last weekend, Trinity took their first step in getting us closer to joining by having a church-wide vote. And the good news is they voted me in as the pastor, which means that I'm pastoring two locations right now. Here's what that means for us, is that I'm going to be traveling between our church and that church and then back to our church on Sunday mornings. So just a little grace if you see me running out of the building to get into a car. It won't be like that forever, I promise you. I'm not that pastor that wants to do that or that I'm looking forward to buying a helicopter or anything. But it takes about 7 minutes to get there, and I think it's going to be pretty easy. That is until we get to one location agreement and we can agree on one place, and we'll do that soon enough. But the most important thing for me is just not to be in a hurry. I want to make sure that we're caring for people and we're doing this. And we want to find, like I said to a friend of mine, Donald, the other day when I was talking to him, I said, listen, we want to find the facility that's going to work best to reach the city of Tacoma. So whatever facility that's going to be, we're going to do that thing eventually. But until then, please be praying. Lots of decisions, lots of meetings. We're going to create some time for us to answer questions for you and for them. And all that stuff is to come. But the first step has been taken. So will you join me as we pray for all of the goings on of that journey? Jesus, thank you for today. Thank you for an opportunity to see two churches come together as one eventually. Lord, that we would be better together. God, I pray today for the message you put on my heart for our church. Help us to hear what you have to say today in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I have a question for you today. How many of you like disappointment in your life? Wait, crowd's kind of quiet, right? Nobody likes disappointment, right? Let me give you a couple examples. Disappointing things that happen in life, job loss, relationship trouble, financial hardship, God not answering the prayers the way that you asked him, the pain of the past, the pain of the present, vacation plans that get postponed, sickness, failure, loss, hope, fear, COVID, all of that, right? Like I needed to mention any of those things. Disappointment is a drag, right? No one likes it. It stinks. But I got a message for you today that I feel like some of us have walked in disappointment over this last year, and I feel like there's something God wants to say to us in the midst of it all. Listen, I remember a season of time when I experienced a kind of a significant bout of disappointment. You might not think so in your world, but for me it was. I remember I was in college. I left school. I started to get the nudge in my heart that I was going to go into pastoral ministry or ministry of some sort. And I remember thinking that was the right leaning. And so I remember enrolling into Bible college from the public college I was in. And I remember I was also going to church here in Tacoma at what was called PSCC before. Now it's Puget Sound Foursquare. I remember being there, going to Bible college and coming to church. And I remember my pastor, the pastor who was here before, he says to me, hey, Lance, I see that there's a call in your life. I think one day you're going to be a fantastic senior pastor. And I was like, wow, thanks, man. He goes, however, that day is not now. He says to me, you just got lots to learn. So I was like, well, I don't doubt that. But he said, let me tell you this. I feel like one of the great ways for you to learn how to be a pastor is going to be doing pastoral ministry. And I thought to myself, wow, that's exactly what I was hoping you would say. So when do I get to preach? When do I get to do whatever? And he said, so here's what that means for me. And I said, what's that? He goes, we need you to be the children's pastor. And I was like, in my mind, on the outside, I was smiling. On the inside, I was like, no, like I love kids and all, but I was like, I want to talk to people who are like big people. And he's like, yeah, but I need a pastor who can talk to people, big or small, right? And so I remember in that process feeling like my dreams of preaching to thousands were all going to be postponed and just disappointment in that whole journey. But, you know, I had a great time, by the way, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that in a minute, but how many of you have experienced disappointment like that? You know, unplanned, maybe you stepped into something, you'd hoped that it had gone a different way, but you just incurred disappointment. Didn't go the way that you thought it would. I got a funny feeling that disappointment is one of those, it's like a class that we all have to take. Disappointment's like a class you have to take. Sometimes you audit the class, sometimes you get a grade on the class, but it's one of those classes I think we all have to take throughout life. But disappointment isn't a fun thing. Disappointment is something that we all sign up for. But disappointment is definitely on the, what are those lists inside of a college deal you have to take? One of the required classes, right? Because I think there's something we learn out of disappointment that we can't learn anywhere else. I want to tell you a story tonight about a guy in the Bible who incurred some disappointment. His name was Peter. Give your Bibles, open it up to Luke chapter 5. Luke chapter 5, you guys know about Peter, also called Simon Peter. In fact, right here in Luke chapter 5, Jesus had met Simon Peter prior to this, In fact, Jesus had his brother, Peter's brother Andrew, had introduced Jesus to Peter in Jerusalem probably weeks before this. So Peter didn't know Jesus all that well. He knew of him. Jesus makes his way from Jerusalem all the way up to Galilee where Peter's fishing, right? So we know that Peter's fishing on the Sea of Galilee, bumps into Jesus at one point where Jesus is preaching in a synagogue. Some people were sick and Jesus healed people and a whole bunch of people started showing up to the synagogue. And then it says that Jesus went from the synagogue to Peter's house. Now it sounds, sometimes we read the Bible and we don't know geography, and it seems like Jesus went from the synagogue to Peter's house and it was like a journey. It literally was like 30 yards. I mean, it wasn't far, but there's just this moment where Jesus goes from the synagogue to Peter's house and bumps into Peter's mother-in-law. And while he's there at Peter's house, Jesus heals Peter's mother-in-law. Like there's a personal encounter that Peter has. It's someone in his life that Jesus had personal contact with and transformed her life. It was amazing. Here we go. Go down to Luke chapter 5, verse 1. It says this. One day, Jesus was preaching on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. Great crowds pressed in on him to listen to the word of God. He noticed two empty boats at the water's edge, for fishermen had left them and were washing their nets. Stepping into one of the boats, Jesus asked Simon, its owner, to push out into the water. So he sat in the boat and he taught the crowds from there. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Now go out where the water is deeper and let down your nets, and you'll catch many fish." "Master," he said in verse 5, "we've worked hard all night last night and didn't catch a thing, but if you say so, then we'll try it again." At this time, there were nets. Their nets were so filled with fish, they began to tear. A shout for help brought their partners in the other boat, and soon both boats were filled with fish on the verge of sinking. When Simon Peter realized what had happened, he fell to his knees before Jesus and said, "Oh Lord, please leave me. I'm much too much a sinner to be around you." For he was awestruck by the size of their catch, as were the others who were with him. His partner James and John, the sons of Zebedee, also were amazed. Jesus replied to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you'll be fishing for people." As soon as they landed, they left everything and followed Jesus. It's amazing to me when I read this story. Peter and his friends go out fishing, right? They do what they've always done. They every night they would go. In fact, we were in Israel a few years ago. You could go out on the Sea of Galilee on the deck of your hotel, and you could see the boats even fishing, even currently. The Sea of Galilee is interesting. It's like one of the only freshwater below sea level lakes in the world. It's amazing. And it's actually the beginning of the Jordan River. It's the big lake the Jordan River feeds into and becomes the Jordan River, which actually goes down into the Dead Sea, which is weird to me that a freshwater lake ends up in saltwater lake. Not the ocean, but the lake. It's nutty to me. Now, Peter and his friends go out fishing. They probably fished. Peter was probably a generational fisherman. In other words, his dad, his grandpa, his grandpa's grandpa, all those guys probably fished. We don't know that for sure, but it's kind of the way that life happened back then. So Peter, career fisherman, gets skunked. No fish. Right now, to you or me going out fishing, that's not a big deal because it's a sport. It's kind of fun. But for them, that's like no paycheck, right? No fish equals no money. No fish equals no diapers. No fish equals no internet, no car, no insurance, no nothing, right? That's what it means to somebody who doesn't catch fish. It just got me thinking about this problem. You know, some of the things we don't know in this story is how long that had happened. In other words, we hear of one night, perhaps. We don't know how long it had been since he had caught fish. Maybe it was weeks. Maybe it was days. But I don't know. Maybe it was just that night. Who knows? Maybe that's the case. But just for fun, let's just imagine that it had been going on and that he had not been catching fish. Let's just assume just for fun that maybe this was a journey that had gone on and something started to settle in him and he started to panic and say, like, what is going on? What used to work isn't working. You know, it set in, right? Disappointment. Disappointment would set in because you start to say, am I a failure? Would I do wrong? God, don't you love me? All the things that we all get to when things don't work like they used to work. I wonder if that was the case. It's interesting. I wonder what it was like when Jesus steps into his empty boat. Jesus just walks up and stepped into his empty boat. I think it's kind of funny because Jesus didn't ask He just jumped in. Jesus just got into his boat, into his empty boat. I don't think that was as much a problem because I think Peter knew of Jesus because his mother-in-law just got healed, right? So I wonder what it was like for him, though, when the crowd of people followed Jesus down to the shore. Because Jesus at that time, by the way, if you want to draw a crowd somewhere, then do what Jesus did. What did Jesus do? Well, he healed people from sicknesses, like for real, not just kinda, but he healed them like for good. And he, you know what else he did? He cast demons out of people, and he full-on gave them hope for heaven. Right? Listen, if you don't draw a crowd, do that. You'll grow a church faster than anything. A lot of people try promising that, right? I'm telling you, the thing that's crazy, there was a lot of humans. And by the way, up in this area of Galilee, it wasn't like there was a lot of people. There's a lot of wilderness. Galilee had humans in it. The city of Capernaum, where this thing was all happening, was really, it was probably about 1,500 people all spread out. So the city proper may have been 500, 700. But it was like it was actually a pretty small fishing community for the most part. You know, it's interesting to me when I read this story. I think to myself sometimes, what must it have been like for Peter that next morning to feel like, gosh, not again. Not again. I thought, not again. I thought I did everything I was supposed to do. I mean, they didn't have all the things we had. Why weren't the fish coming? I wonder if all the rest of the fishermen were feeling the same thing, or maybe they were all being skunked. I don't know. I had this fundamental belief. I got a funny feeling that Peter had to fail. I think Peter had to incur. I think this was one of those classes that Peter had to take. And I think in the process of him enrolling in the class called disappointment made him come to some sort of senses and realize that his life wasn't to be wrapped up in fishing for fish. Right? In other words, I wrote it this way. I think Peter had to fail at catching fish in order for him to really succeed at leading people. I think he had to fail at fishing so he could succeed at leading people. Here's my question for this morning. What makes a guy go from being a generational fisherman, the only real skill he probably thought he had, to an empty fishing boat and being willing to leave it all to follow Jesus? I always wonder what the conversation was like with Peter and his wife, right? What did that go down like? Hey, hon, bumped into Jesus today, right? You like him. I mean, you can imagine him saying to his wife, you like Jesus. Remember, he healed your mom yesterday? Like, I just imagine. Hey, honey, here's the thing. So Jesus came down. We didn't have fish. We caught a bunch of fish. And then he asked me to leave it all, follow him, and get paid nothing. Got any thoughts? I just wonder what that went down like. Like, I can only imagine his wife was like, okay, that's such a bad idea. You just caught a bunch of fish with him. Keep him around and we'll just keep bringing in fish. I mean, like, I only imagine what it must have been like, right? It's funny what kind of bargaining we get. Listen, what brings a guy from an empty net to a higher calling? Because that's what happened to Peter. We know the end of the story, right? We have the advantage of 20/20 hindsight. We can look backwards and we can say, well, Peter became the apostle, the leading members, if you will, one of the key people in the narrative of the beginning of the church, right? We know that. But I wonder, what brings a guy from a fishing vessel to the leading of a church, an empty net to a higher calling? I think the first thing is this. Number one, what brings a guy from an empty net to a higher calling? Number one, an attention to God's word. I think an attention to God's word. Luke 5:1 says this. One day Jesus was preaching on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. Great crowds were pressing in on him, listening for the word of God. You know, it's amazing. So it's interesting to me, when I read my Bible, I try to slow down and read each word because each word has a meaning. I'll go back to the original Hebrew or Greek and not so much Aramaic, but oftentimes I'll see like there's something in the meaning of the words. Sometimes I try to take it at face value. So I looked up the word cleaning. And Peter was cleaning his nets, right? So it dawned on me like, what? Why was he cleaning his nets? He didn't catch anything. What needed to be cleaned? There's sometimes in the Bible when I see the humor sometimes, like, for example, here, I could be wrong, but I feel like the writer Luke, inspired by the Holy Spirit, might have been trying to cover up for Peter. In other words, I feel like I wonder if he was like, okay, Peter was cleaning his nets. Like the next sentence was like, because he caught no fish. I'm like, I just don't know how we missed that, right? He didn't catch it. Well, here's what I think Peter was doing. I think Peter was listening to Jesus. And he was sitting there trying to clean his nets. He was trying to come up with an excuse for like he had to listen, right? I think he was listening to Jesus the whole time, but he couldn't just sit there and do nothing, right? Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe he really was cleaning the junk off the nets. Who knows? All I know is this, is he was there, right? Peter was there. This is interestingly enough that Jesus was preaching. Now, the New Living Translation, NIV, just basically says Jesus was preaching. The original languages and even the NAS or ASV versions actually say this. Jesus was preaching words that come from God. Your Bible might say he was preaching the word of God, right? Now we can say that in church and think and know what it means. But here the actual translation is this. Jesus was preaching the word that comes from God. But keep in mind, Peter just encountered Jesus healing his mother-in-law, setting people free from demons. Now he hears Jesus preaching words that come from God. And something about the words that come from God transformed Peter. I think it's amazing how often we try hearing words that aren't from God, but we just feel like we need to hear them. See, maybe that's the reason we feel so disappointed or that we're struggling with getting through our struggle or our disappointment is because we're not listening for the words that come from God. We're trying to listen to words that come from Twitter or words that come from Instagram or Facebook, an instant messenger. It's like, I feel like there's this, we just want a word. We want someone to click like. We want something instead of what the words that come from God. Now, listen to a couple of words that come from God. Here it says in Deuteronomy 31:6, be strong, he says, and courageous. Don't be afraid. The Lord your God will go ahead of you. He will neither fail you nor forsake you. Isaiah 41 says this. This is more words from God. Don't be afraid, he says in Isaiah, for I am with you. Don't be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my victorious right hand. Psalm 55:22 says this. Give your burdens to the Lord, and he will take care of you, for he will not permit the godly to slip and fall. See, those are words that come from God. Those words don't change. Those words are real. Those words we can hang on to. And I fear that some of us have been spending more time trying to hear words that come from somewhere else because we're hoping the other word, the encouragement, the like, the you got this word, I like you, I agree with you, all those kinds of words that somehow make us feel good in the moment. But they're not the words that come from God. They're words that come from people, which are great. But it's the words that come from God that transform us. Right? Let me tell you number two. How does a guy go from an empty net to a higher calling? Number two, let Jesus into your boat. Let Jesus into your boat. You know, by the way, the acoustics at that time on the Sea of Galilee, you know, you've been on a lake before or you've been on the shore and you've heard people out. I think it's most embarrassing is you go to like Lake Taps or you go somewhere and hear somebody out on a boat arguing and you're like, hey, we can hear you. Like there's that thing, right? Jesus asked Peter to push out a little bit because you could hear better. And there were thousands of people showing up for this sermon that Jesus was preaching. Isn't it amazing? I feel like sometimes for us, in the way that we live our lives, we fail to let Jesus into our boat. We fail to stop and just listen to Jesus. Now, by the way, last week I told you that you got to get out of the boat. Different story, right? That was in the middle of a storm. This message today is about allowing Jesus into your world. Allowing Jesus into your world. In fact, I wrote a definition for your boat. Your boat is what represents safety, security, apart from God. Your boat is what represents safety and security to you apart from God. Right? I feel like sometimes we get so wound up thinking that we're going to find our safety and security, our identity, our purpose, our comfort, everything else, instead of saying, Jesus, I want that to come from you. You know, when you ask Jesus into your boat, he brings along with him safety and comfort and security and all of that stuff, purpose. You know, I feel like sometimes we fight so hard to try to maintain our courage, our thing, or whatever it is, because we feel like that's the thing that's going to keep us afloat. That feels like our security in our boat. You know, sometimes I remember when my kids were little, we'd put them to bed, you know, and you take a 5 or 7 or 10-year-old, put them to bed, and they my kids would lose their loving minds at bedtime, man. They would be like, they thought that the world was ending. They thought, you know, no one loved them because we were having to go to bed. You know, the moment when they finally gave up and they just rested, and they realized like, oh, and you walked in and looked at them while they were sleeping as a parent. And you just thought, look how peaceful. 20 minutes ago, there was no peace in this house, right? That, like, I love the fact that like the peace. I feel like God sometimes says, hey, let me into your boat and I can bring you to that place. that place of peace. Now, here's the question I have for you is, what do you have to do to allow Jesus into your boat? What is it in your life that you have to do to allow Jesus to enter into your boat? Remember, Jesus wants to give you his identity, his purpose, his comfort. Is it fear? Is it sin? Is it shame? What's keeping you from saying, Jesus, come in? Like, I wonder what Peter was like when he was dealing. He might have been embarrassed to have Jesus step into his boat. I mean, there was no fish scales. There was no fish guts. There was nothing. It was clean. Maybe your boat is crystal clean because you've spent no time stepping into something that would cause it to get a little messy. Number three, how about this? Well, how do you go from an empty net to a higher calling? Number three, push out where the water's just a little over your head. Push out where the water's deeper. Luke 5:4 says this, when he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, now go out where the water's deeper and let your nets down and you'll catch many fish. I feel like so many Christians spend so much time around in the shallow end of the pool. We just splash around the shallow end. We could stand up. We can splash each other. We can splash ourselves. Nothing's wrong with the shallow end. It just stays super shallow, right? A mile wide and a half inch deep. You could say you're in the pool. No question. But I wonder what it's like, why Christians just stay in the shallow end so long. You know, it's interesting to me that Jesus told Peter to push out where it was deeper. Now, it was silly because during that particular time frame, in the heat of the day, was the worst time to fish. Because over there in Israel, it gets super hot and the fish would go down deep. And the way that they caught fish wasn't on a line and a hook. It was really more they would throw out nets and the nets would sink down. They were only so, because fish always came to the surface at night. And then the nets, they'd pull in the bottom of it and then they would kind of yank in the nets and that's how they'd catch the fish. And so it would be silly to try to throw out nets at noon or 1 or even 10 o'clock in the morning because they would drop down and they would pull, all the fish were beneath it, right? It wouldn't make any sense. It's amazing to me that Jesus asked Peter to go out where the water was over their heads. Go out where it was deeper. Let me tell you what brings somebody to find success through disappointment when you finally go out where the water's a little deeper. Listen, I wrote this down. Is it possible that God wants to take you where you can't control the narrative? Is it possible that God wants to bring you to a place that you can't touch the ground so that you can't control the narrative? I think too many of us feel like the shallow end's great because I can control the narrative. I can decide when I want to get in, when I want to get out. If someone's going to push me, I can catch my balance. All that stuff, right? Is it entirely possible that God wants to bring us as Christians out where the water's a little over our heads because then we can't control the narrative? We get to sit back and say, God, you are the one in control. You are the one I trust. I believe, honestly, that that's where God wants to bring us all, to the place where we're absolutely trusting in him completely. That's what it means to be a Christian. It means one that fully yields, one that fully trusts. In my opinion, fully lets go of control and yields to him. How do you go from a place of an empty net to a higher calling? Pay attention to God's word. Let Jesus into your boat and push out where the water's a little deeper and over your head. You know, I pastored the kids' ministry at Puget Sound Christian Center for a while. I level with you, in my first go about at doing that, I was a little awkward because at that time, I think we might have had a baby, but he was little. Jansen was just a year old maybe. And I remember not understanding kids or ministry really. But I remember one night praying for the kids at our ministry, that the ones that I'm now pastoring and leading. And I remember as I was praying, I was like, but Jesus, in my heart of hearts, I just want to pastor their parents. I want to pastor the ones who are going to listen and understand the Greek verbiage and the Hebrew and all that stuff. And I remember this little whisper that God told me. He said, hey, Lance, I got to tell you something that you would never learn any other way. I was like, what's that? And he said, Lance, I want to tell you this. You know that those kids have the same size Jesus in their hearts that the parents do, right? And I was like, wait, what? He goes, yeah, they have the same size Jesus, Lance. They didn't get like a mini kid-size Holy Spirit. They got the full meal deal. So how about you preach a message to them as if you were going to go off to some foreign land? How about you learn how to speak their language so that they can see me? Gosh, it changed me. I was never the same. I feel like I was never the same. The disappointing moment in my life that I thought was a demotion. That's pathetic I would even say that. But that place in my life that God said, listen, I can't teach you this lesson any other way. You've got to experience the end of you. And so I did. I became the children's and youth pastor. And to this day, I don't know how long it went. I don't even know if any kids' lives were changed. But I can tell you that mine was. And I'll never be the same. See, listen, maybe you're going through a disappointment right now. And Jesus is telling you, hey, follow me. Come on. Let's push out where the water's a little over your head. I got something to say to you. And you're not willing to listen until we get out there. Maybe that's where you find yourself today. Listen, if that's you, maybe you should hit the pause button and just spend a minute with Jesus. And let him take you out where it's a little deeper. Let me pray for you today. God, thank you for this moment. This holy moment, Lord, that we couldn't find any other way. Some people who are incurring all kinds of difficulty right now. Things that used to work just fine in their marriages don't seem to be working just fine right now. Things that used to be working great in their jobs aren't working like they used to work. Maybe things in their relationships aren't what they were. But today, God, you're calling into a place of completely deeper water. Lord, I pray you speak. Can you just say that with me in your heart of hearts? Say, Jesus, speak to me today. The water's over my head. I can't solve this problem on my own. I need you, God. In Jesus' name. Amen. Well, listen, I love you. I hope you have a great afternoon today. Be blessed.
Hey, before we go, I want to remind you that you can find all of the information at PugetSoundFoursquare.com, on the Church Center app, or on our socials at Foursquare. So continue to be faithful in your walk with the Lord, get connected with community, and continue to live up and live out, loving God and loving people. Just a friendly reminder that if you're meeting with us online, it will be here at 10 a.m., but we are meeting in person at church at 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. Can't wait to be with everyone again next week. Be safe, take care, and we love you, church.